From the City Pulse newsroom at 99 Queen Street East, this is Toronto Television, Channel 57, Cable 7. City TV, everywhere.
Tonight, no decision yet in the Morgenthaler trial.
Tonight, Mulroney's first parliament.
Tonight, Penthouse under pressure.
Now, the latest from the City Pulse news team with Gord Martineau, Anne Moskowski, Brian Hill, Jim McKenney, and John Burgess. This is City Pulse Tonight.
Good evening. First tonight, a vicious stabbing in Toronto's West End.
It happened on St. Clarence Avenue in the Dupont Lansdowne neighborhood. The victim is a male. We have details tonight from Chief Assignment Editor Glenn Cole.
And 14 division officers faced a grisly scene when they arrived at 730 St. Clarence tonight. A man was bleeding severely from 7 stab wounds to the chest. A suspect's description was immediately put out over the air.
Here's another one. PC patrol at all units. Suspect went southbound.
To the assistance from City Pulse cameraman Mike Ned. Finally, a man was taken into custody on the 18th floor of that building and taken to 14th Division. He is presently being charged with attempt murder. The victim, a 45-year-old man, is just now moving into surgery at Toronto General Hospital. No names have been released. Anne?
Thank you, Glenn. Surprisingly tonight, still no verdict in the Colin Thatcher first-degree murder trial. The jury has been out since noon Friday. Today, jurors returned to the court to have earlier testimony read back. The 7 men, 5 women, wanted to go over testimony by Craig Dotson. Dotson had told the court he saw a man leave Joanne Wilson's garage, and then he found Wilson in a pool of blood. If the jury cannot reach a verdict, a new trial will be ordered. Here in Toronto, still no verdict in the Morgenthaler trial. Lauren Honickman tells us tonight the jury is behind closed doors after receiving further instructions from the judge.
Associate Chief Justice William Parker charged the 6-man, 6-woman jury for more than 3.5 hours and spent a great portion of that time shredding the arguments the defense had raised. In what he called the weakness in the defense of necessity, Parker said the fact that a person wants an abortion does not mean they are entitled to one. He said the statistics show there have been no deaths from a legal abortion since 1975. He told the jury if they accept necessity as a defense, they must find that an emergency situation existed so serious that the accused had no choice but to break the law. He said, it took the accused 6 months to get the clinic open. Was that a reasonable response to an emergency? In referring to the fact the accused broke the law that they thought was wrong, Parker said, breaking the law for a cause is still breaking the law. Parker also refused to the testimony of defense witness Dr. Diane Sachs, who expressed the same concerns about her abortion laws as the accused. Parker said, she didn't break the law. She just referred her patients to Buffalo or Quebec. Defense lawyer Morris Manning had told the jury, acquit and you shall send a message to Parliament. Parker told the jury to disregard the statement, saying, you are jurors, not legislatures. This case is not to decide whether or not our abortion law should be changed.
I have no comment, none whatsoever, until tomorrow.
Nothing you can tell us at all?
No, nothing at all.
Watch your back, guys, watch your back.
It wouldn't be proper that I tell you anything.
Well, I just wondered how... Just your opinion of the whole charge.
I feel fine. I feel fine and optimistic. That's all I can tell you.
Morris Manning had close to 2 hours of objections. He said to Parker, your charge may have taken away my whole defense, which point Parker said, maybe it did. Parker sequestered the jury in a hotel tonight. He told them not to begin their deliberations till he's finished recharging them tomorrow morning. Lauren Honickman at the Morgenthaler trial, City Pulse tonight.
Police in Orangeville are looking for clues tonight after the bodies of 2 children were found in a schoolyard. Terrell and Joe spent the day with homicide investigators on the scene.
The bodies of 11-year-old Daniel Babineau and his 9-year-old sister Monique were found here at St. Peter's Catholic School at 10 o'clock last night. A policeman found their bodies just 1 hour after their parents had reported them missing.
They were lying on the ground, a graveled area, one was between two portables. One was in front of a portable, but within roughly 20 feet of one another. It's possible that they were strangled.
Although the children's bodies were fully clothed, police say they won't know if they had been sexually assaulted until an autopsy is completed. Police are also trying to determine if the children were killed at the scene or killed elsewhere and their bodies dumped at the school. Daniel and Monique were students at St. Peter's School, which is closed up today as the police investigation continues. In this family photo, Daniel is on the right wearing the red shirt. Monique is to the left wearing a white shirt and blue shorts. The Babineaux lived here at 54 Rustic Crescent, just a few blocks away from the school. Daniel and Monique were last seen by their parents at 5 o'clock yesterday when the parents left home to take an older child to the city's hockey arena. When another child arrived home at 5:20, Daniel and Monique were gone.